I'm fine and I'm very excited about the last top 8 match we are going to show you. First of all, we'll take a short look at the bracket we have here. We are going to feature the match between Yee Wei Chun and Tord Reklev. Both of them are playing Yveltal Garbodor. The game we didn't stream was won by Jacob Lissage, also with Yveltal Garbodor. Philip Schulz won also with Yveltal Garbodor. And then we have Michael Premwet. You can guess which deck he played. Also Yveltal Garbodor. So we have a lot of... We only have Yveltal Garbodors left in the whole tournament. And that really shows us how great this deck is if it's piloted by a good player.
Yeah, absolutely. No matter who ends up winning this match, Yveltal Garbodor is guaranteed to fill that last top 4 slot, making the top 4 all Yveltal Garbodor. When is the last time we saw a deck be this dominant, really, in the format?
Well, it was some time. So here we have Yee Wei Chun from Malaysia. He also had a... good showings at international and his national tournaments, good showings at the World Championship and the Malaysian National Championship. He has some very, very, very interesting list. He also had a 10-1-2 record, so he only lost one game throughout the tournament yet. And, well, when you play Yveltal Garbodor, you have to play a lot of mirror matches. So you play against other Yveltal Garbodor decks once, so these players are prepared for this matchup. So this will be a really, really great game, I think. Yes.
Yeah, he's also the first seed going into the top 8, so of course he had the best record throughout, adding up the record from day 1 and day 2. He came out on top of everyone, which means that he will be playing against Tord Reklev, who is our 8th seed. We saw him on stream a couple of times, actually. We saw Tord on stream both in day 1 and in day 2, and as we already mentioned, he will also be playing the Yveltal Garbodor deck, also a very accomplished player himself, and you can see there his results coming up now, several different national championships, in fact 2016, 2014 and 2012. He was the Norwegian national champion and also a European Challenge Cup in the top 4 in 2012 to round it off. An incredible player.
Yeah, I actually played against Tord quite a lot, and it's always one of these players when you see the name on the match slip and you're just, oh, not this guy. This will be a hard one. And these are, now that you are at the end of this tournament in the top 8 slot, of course, there will be only good players left, and when both players play the same deck, you often tend to have either a very, very dumb match, which is just who gets good cards, who gets the knockout faster, but when your deck has a hard time getting these one-hit knockouts, the mirror matches tend to be very, very tactical, where you have to think about which options you're using, which Pokémon you're going to use, and here we see Yee Wei starting the game.
Yes, so we are off with the final stream top 8 match here for the International Championships, and yeah, Yee Wei Chun is going to go first. He's going to start off with an Ultra Ball, going to discard a Professor Sycamore and a Dark Energy, and well, it's already looking pretty good for him, so he'll be able to start setting himself up quite nicely. We can see from his list that he's not playing too many, you know, tricks, I guess, although there is one specific Pokemon which probably he's not gone for right now. He's just gone for that Fright Knight Yveltal, of course, but there is an interesting Darkrai in his list.
Yeah, the promo Darkrai from Generations. I'm not entirely sure if it will be that important in this matchup, but first of all, I would like to take a quick look at Yee Wei's list. So he does play Delinquent and also Pokemon Central Lady, two very common cards that can help in this matchup here. Delinquent can kind of force your opponent to always have more than 3 hand cards in their hand, so they cannot always go for the optimal play, especially when you have Delinquent in your discard pile already and a lot of Versus Seeker played, so they cannot really risk to go down to that low amount of hand cards. So you kind of force them to not play the optimal way just by having this card in your deck. You don't even need to actually play it. The other card is Pokemon Central Lady, which helps a lot with the Fright Knight Yveltal, which actually is on his bench right now. Yeah. And he also has Enhanced Hammer, which you can use to discard opponent's double colors energy cards.
Yeah, we've seen Enhanced Hammer crop up so much over the course of this tournament because it works out well in so many different matchups. Against in the mirror, you can use it to swing the tempo back in your favor in terms of energy attachments by discarding double colorless energies. And even as we saw yesterday against Greninja, now that they're all playing Splash Energy, if they decide to do an attack where you end up not taking energy back to the hand, say by doing a Shadow Stitching or a Moonlight Slash for 60 instead of 80, then you can discard those two. There's just pretty much in every single matchup you're playing against, apart from maybe Volcanion, Enhanced Hammer is a useful card, so it's no surprise to see it cropping up in so many lists.
Yeah, this is true. So here we just see energy attachments with Max Elixir, Shaman setup, Trainer's Mail. So he's just going for, yeah, drawing some cards. Let's see what his deck is going to give him. he also has two Peril City in play, so often players are just trying to get like their Shamans off, then play Peril City to themselves. But he also attached the Fighting Fury Belt to his Yveltal, Fright Knight, which usually doesn't really do a lot unless you set up your Garbodor. So it is always interesting to see which players do set up the Garbodor and the Mirror Match and which players do not. And most of them tend to not do, but there are also a lot of situations where it makes sense. Also, you can just have the option to just bench a Trailbrush with a Floatstone, then you can always put it active. And then when it makes sense to evolve, you can do it right there. So it really depends on how your cards are and how the match is going in general.
Yeah, you can set it up so that, like you said, it's always there, and you can control it to when the optimal time to evolve into Garbodor and, you know, trigger that ability is, then you can just do that. And of course, at that point, the Fright Knight ability will no longer work. And you can, for example, do Pitch Black Spear for 70 to the active and 60 to eventually X instead. And you also put it up to 170 HP, which can be a bit of a struggle to deal with. You know, it's a lot of damage for the Yveltal to be putting out. And especially when there's the extra 40 HP from the Fighting Fury Belt to deal with, it can, yeah, be a real struggle.
Yeah, and Tord's hand is looking great here. He does have a Max Elixir, he has Ultra Ball, two basic energies, actually one of them he just discarded with Ultra Ball. So this way he can also go for Oblivion Wing, attach to one of the basic energies active, then use Max Elixir. His other card is End, so he doesn't have to discard the double colorless energy cards. So you can go for either the Fright Knight Yveltal or Yveltal EX, depending on what he thinks fits better in this situation. The advantage of not taking a Pokemon EX here would be that he doesn't get damaged by Pitch Black Spear on the bench, which it seems like Tords is going for. Also, Yee Wei already has two Pokemon EX on his bench, so the Pitch Black Spear will deal the double damage. And as long as Tord is able to get the energy with the Max Elixir, he can deal 30 damage on the active Pokemon, which then only has 100 HP, so two Pitch Black Spears would knock out the Yveltal on the active spot. But however, it always really depends on what your opponent is going for, so you need to make sure everything works out. As we see, Tord Max Elixir is unfortunately not hitting, so he might go for a different way of playing this.
Yeah, for now that the Garbodor isn't out, the Fright Knight's ability coming into play is quite good for Yee Wei, because what it means is Tord has a lot less versatility with what he can attack with this turn. It means that Floatstone, of course, is no longer a retreating option for him to get that Oblivion Wing Yveltal out of the active. But he's attached to it anyway, so I think Tord's thinking to himself, I can get a Dark Energy in the discard pile, I can just do Oblivion Wing and, you know, start ramping up the energy on my side of the field, and this is a fine play to make anyway, so in the end it works out.
Yeah, also the Yveltal has two retreat costs, so even if the Fright Knight is active, you cannot just retreat for like one Darkness energy, which would be great. So you can use Oblivion Wing, then retreat, you don't really lose the energy, but get 30 damage off just right there. Tord is also playing the promo Jirachi, which with a Stardust attack can discard a special energy card attached to the active Pokemon from your opponent, then also deal 10 damage on the way, but the next turn you doesn't get damage from attacks. So that's a great card in the mirror match as well, similar to what Enhanced Hammer does, but you also get the advantage of not getting damage next turn. Yee Wei's turn here is really, really short. He just attached an energy and went for a Pitch Black Spear, so maybe his hand isn't looking that good. I unfortunately cannot see it right now. There also now is a Parallel City in play, limiting Tord's bench space, so stuff like Jirachi, Shaman EX, and Yveltal EX, Trailbush, you get limited by what you can do. And since both players only play Parallel City as their stadium card, it's very hard for them to get rid of it once it's in play. So now Tord has less options in general, and he cannot be just like bench Pokemon he doesn't want to have anymore. As he also just goes for a second Oblivion Wing, both players are not playing supporter. However, you need to notice that Tord actually has an N in his hand, but he opts not to play it because, well, since his opponent's turn didn't had so many cards in it, you usually assume like his hand is not looking great. But of course in the mirror match you can do these next level plays like Tord, and I think Tord and Yee Wei are both doing right now. Just try to figure out the opponent's hand cards, try to figure out what I can do during my turn, what the opponent is doing during their turn, and then maybe even just not going for support at all.
Yeah, and it's all these things and more that you have to think about when you're in a mirror matchup. Of course, if you're in a matchup against a deck where you pretty much know how it's going to play out most of the time because of, you know, certain weaknesses, type weaknesses or things like that, then it's more easy to get an idea of what you need to do. But when you're faced against a deck list that you know is going to be at least 50 cards similar to yours, then knowing in advance what you can actually do to give yourself that slight edge that can turn it from a 50-50 into a 55-45 is really what makes a difference difference between winning and losing, and what makes the difference between being in top eight and not? Because obviously these guys have had to do this throughout the course of the day one and day two, because they will inevitably have faced multiple Yveltal, Garbodor, Mirrors in order to get here.
Yeah, this is true. So here we see a double colors entry card being attached to the bench Yveltal EX. I'm unfortunately didn't quite catch exactly what's going on here. The judge took Yee Wei's deck, and he is showing a max elixir. So maybe he just accidentally flipped the card over, or he's wanting to play this, but we will find out later anyway. So yeah, it just seems he just goes for the Max Elixir, unfortunately not finding an energy card, and getting these Max Elixirs in play is very important. One notable thing is that Tord only plays 3 of the Max Elixirs, while Yee Wei plays 4. I think most of the players play 4 of them, however, apparently it's not that big of a deal to only play 3, since Tord also made his way into the top 8 with only losing one game, but he has more ties.
Yeah. I mean, the only problem playing 3 means for you is that in a mirror match you could, in theory, fall behind on tempo a lot, especially considering that, you know, on average, because these Yveltal Garbodor lists tend to play 9 dark energy, you normally only hit, say, half of your max elixirs, so say like 2, so On average, in the case of playing 3, you should hit, what, 1.5? Which obviously, you can't literally only hit 1.5, but it means that you're less likely to be able to hit more max elixirs, so it's a way to fall behind and lose that mirror edge, which, as we've just discussed, is so crucial.
Yeah, now that Yee Wei had a very great turn, now Tord has to consider his game again. Like I already said, he had a lot of cards in his hand that he could have used, and now he needs to make a decision. Since he has 2 energies attached to the active Yveltal, he is able to retreat it, but now he has to consider if it makes a lot of sense to go for the Pitch Black Spear right away, or if it makes sense to wait, or maybe just bench the Yveltal EX and then attach an energy right there.
Yeah, and right now it's a little bit of a tricky situation because, of course, as soon as Tord benches an EX, that Pitch Black Spear just becomes a lot more valuable because it will be doing 60 to it, and he is deciding that he has to just go for it at this point. And also interesting, we see he decides to attach a third energy to the Yveltal in the active, so we could maybe be thinking about going for a Darkness Blade here?
Yeah, I completely forgot Darkness Blade. It actually makes a lot of sense here because you can just take the knockout immediately for 1 energy card. So you invest 1 energy to get 3 energies from your opponent in the discard pile, then Yee Wei can take the knockout here, but the fact that you have 3 energies attached doesn't really make a difference anyways, because even a Sky Return could knock out the Yveltal at this point anyways. So I actually really like this play. I completely forgot that Darkness Blade is even a thing. And these are the things that you need to think about when you play against these decks. All of the Yveltals, at least Oblivion Wing and the Yveltal EX, have 2 attacks. And often you just forget what your opponent might be going for, and when you play the deck and are not very experienced with playing it, you also do these mistakes where going for the Darkness Blade is just a better play, but you use this Oblivion Wing Yveltal. This is the reason why everyone calls it like this, mainly just to use Oblivion Wing. So yeah, I really like this play a lot.
Yeah, it's really, really cool to see that there, and a really good timing on his part to go for it there, because as you see there, now Yee Wei has evolved into Garbodor, and as soon as he gets a Float Stone on that, then that means the Fright Knight ability will be switched off, and the Fighting Fury belt will kick back in. Had that been the case, 100 damage would actually not have been enough for a knockout on the Fright Knight Yveltal.
Yes, so just going for N, he promoted the Yveltal, which already has double colors, entry card, and a Float Stone. No Fright Knight active, so he can just retreat on the bench again, but he did not decide to attach energy to the Pokemon with the Floatstone, but the one with the Fighting Fury Belt, giving him more HP. He also has the option to use Wise Cyclone, so it will be interesting to see what he's going for. He can just take the knockout with every Pokemon, so he has a choice between just using Sky Return, attaching an energy active to use Wise Cyclone, and move the Double Colors energy to the bench, or just going for the Double Colors energy card on the bench, then using Evil Ball, applying pressure by just having an Yveltal with a lot of energy cards attached to it. Yeah, but it will be interesting to see which attacks he's going for.
Yeah, so White Cyclone is one of those. I'd argue it's probably one of the most important attacks you use in the mirror, because at the same time, if you're not taking one hit knockout anyway, then by doing White Cyclone, you're doing damage whilst simultaneously conserving your energy, so that not only if you do get knocked out, then that energy doesn't get knocked off the field, but you're less likely to be knocked out anyway because you have less energy on yourself to be punished by your opponent's Evil Ball. White Cyclone is, I'd argue, it's probably the most important attack to consider in the mirror.
Yeah, White Cyclone is just a great attack in general. You can conserve your energy cards, not just that you then can move more energies to the benched Yveltal, so either the Fright Knight Yveltal, the Yveltal EX, or in Yue's case, actually the promo Darkrai, to just deal more damage with later Evil Balls or just play your energies in a smart way. And then having less energies attached for the opponent's Evil Ball. So this is, I think, one of the main reasons why this is such a tactical mirror match, because often it makes sense to just attack with Evil Ball, even though you have enough energies to go for a Wild Cycle and also take the knockout with Wild Cycle just for future plays. But you always have to consider what is likely that my opponent has, and do I want to take the risk of getting knocked out by maybe two Elixirs hitting.
Yeah, that promo Darkrai that we mentioned right at the beginning of the match, we see that Yue has actually benched that now, opting to move the energy from the Wild Cyclone to it. So it has a couple of very interesting attacks. So the second attack is the main one we really want to look at. So for two dark energy and a colorless, Abyssal Sleep does 80 damage, and then your opponent's active Pokemon is asleep, but instead of flipping normal one coin of heads that you need to wake up, you instead have to flip two coins, and both of them have to be heads. If either of them are tails, the Pokemon stays asleep. This could be absolutely huge against Tord, because an important thing to note about Tord's list is that because his tricks fall more towards, say, playing the Jirachi, and we know he also plays one Yveltal Break, he doesn't play Pokemon Center Lady or Olympia, which are normally out to, you know, getting out of some sort of status condition. So if he stays asleep, then he could potentially just lose a turn from that.
Yeah, the only thing I'm wondering about is Yui moving the double color energy card to the Darkrai EX, non-EX, because it needs two darkness energies for both of them attack, and then additionally one colorless energy card. So double colors doesn't really give him an advantage. However, I'm not sure if he knows that Tord plays Enhanced Hammer, and also this way Tord cannot use Stardust, which otherwise he would be able to, and then win a turn. So the only question is, does he really want to attack with Abyssal Hand, having four energy cards attached to a Darkrai, which then will get immediately knocked out? I mean, at this point it doesn't really make any difference anyways, because when you have three energy cards, it's enough for the one-hit knockout anyways, as long as there is no Fighting Fuel Belt attached. And by the way, I'm speaking, you see that there are a lot of ifs and whens in this matchup. So many tools that have different effects on the whole game. You have to be very careful of what your opponent's list is playing. And yeah, there are just a lot of little things going on here. This makes it especially hard to also just not to predict the players, but also to just say on what is a better play, because it's not that obvious as in other matchups, for example.
Yeah, I think that Yee Wei as well, the reason why he knows that going for the Darkrai is a good idea, because he's made it very obvious that he knows the way Tord's list is structured. So by going for the Abyssal Sleep play later on, if he is offered the opportunity to, then like I said, Tord is... he knows that Tord is unlikely to have an out, and given that he's spread his energy around with the Wild Cyclone in a way where Stardust is going to have the least impact on him, I think it's safe to say that Yee knows what Tord might be planning.
Yeah, I'm wondering, there's a Garbodor in Yee's bench, but it doesn't have a tool, but Tord just attached a Fighting Fuel Belt to his Frightened Yveltal, so... and here he just retreats into Jirachi, so... it's a problematic decision he had to make. He either had the chance between... he could have attacked with the Frightened Yveltal, but then he had four energy cards, so he would get knocked out immediately anyways, because Evil Ball needs two energies at least. And here we just sacrifice his Stardust Jirachi. Now Yui doesn't have to worry about this anymore, unless Tord plays... does he have Super Rod in his list? I'm actually not sure.
No, he doesn't.
Yeah, so now he doesn't have to worry about the Jirachi anymore. So it's a cool thing, you can plan your energies a bit more. Also, given that Tord doesn't play Enhanced Hammer, I think that's a big relief on Yue's side, because now he can just be more careful, more predictive in his way, because there aren't a lot of tricks in Tord's list. Nothing, like you already said, nothing like Center Lady or Team Flare Ground or that kind of stuff. The only thing he has, Delinquent, and then just a lot of cards and consistency stuff.
Yeah, his tricks are, as we said before, more focused on the Pokemon line. Like, we see that actually not all Yveltal lists even play the Oblivion Wing Yveltal from XY. He's playing one of those. Not all lists play Yveltal Break. He's playing one of those. Definitely not all lists play Jirachi, and he's playing one of those. Those are his choices in terms of what he thinks will give him the most edge in the most matchups.
Yeah, Tord is just passing his turn again, so kind of problematic. Yui has now, again, a little choice. He can attach an energy active and then, in theory, go for a Wild Cyclone or Evil Ball again. The Evil Ball here will deal 80-90 damage because of the Fighting Fury Belt, but the Wild Cyclone deals 100 damage, and he decides to move the energy back to the bench Yveltal EX. So now he has two very decently set up Yveltals, and Tord is kind of forced to move here to do anything at all at some point, but his hand doesn't really look that great. But let's see what he's going for. Yeah.
You mentioned earlier how the Garbodor on Yee Wei's side doesn't have a tool on it. I think Yee Wei is doing this on purpose. I think he recognizes that right now it's more beneficial for abilities to be turned on than not. And he knows that at the optimal turn, he can just, you know, if he sees the float zone, put it on there. And if at that point he's not afraid of, say, the Tord's Yveltal Fright Knight having the Fighting Fury belts actually workable, then he'll know he's okay to deal with that.
Yeah, there are two ways to kind of like have Garbodor prepared. So either just not evolve your Trubbish but have a Floodstone attached to it, or evolve your Trubbish and not attach a Floodstone yet. However, here Tord in the future can force Yue to attach a Floodstone to his Garbodor by just playing Lysander. So this could be a very interesting turnaround for this game. However, Tord now just goes for the Pitch Black Spear and break evolves his Yveltal. So this gives him additionally 20 HP. So you might think, well, there's a Fighting Fury belt. Of course, you need to keep in mind that this is shut off right now. So now he gets 20 extra HP. And these 20 extra HP means Yee Wei needs another energy, but he does have the double colors energy card in his hand. So kind of unfortunate for Tord that this play didn't work out as he wanted.
Yeah, I think Tord was hoping that Yee Wei wouldn't have another energy in hand to get a knockout, but Yee does, and so now we're going to likely see a knockout on this Yveltal break in the active, which is, yeah, a little bit of a shame for Tord at this point.
Yeah, so he just goes for Versus Seeker, and both Yee Wei has 4 prize cards, Tord only has 5, so it's not a very disruptive card. However, the field just looks very different. Yee Wei has a lot of energies on his active Yveltal, he has 3 energies on his bench Yveltal EX, and then the double call energy card to the Darkrai, which right now is not going to be a threat, but with Max Elixir in theory you can set it up in one turn. Yeah. Abyssal Hand is actually quite a funny to like stop your opponent from retreating, and right now the 80 damage, if it comes to this situation, is also enough to knock out the Yveltal on Tord's bench, which already has 100 damage on it. So I don't really think we are going to see this, but it's also something Tord consistently have to keep in mind. But right now, the biggest threat is this active Yveltal.
Yeah, one really, you were mentioning sort of energy counts and how it looks right now in terms of the two of them against each other. One really good way to measure who's actually ahead in the current game is by number of energy on the board. Something that really crops up again and again when we're talking about these high-level competitive games is that being ahead on prizes doesn't always, most of the time, it means that you're probably winning, but so a lot of the time as well, it means that you might be almost taking too much of a lead, and then you can maybe get punished by an N. And if your board isn't then well set up enough, your opponent can then just, you know, snowball from there and actually make a huge comeback. So it's really good that Yee Wei has so much energy ready to go on his field. That means that even if he's, you know, taking this steamrolling lead, he's not going to get punished for it by an N later, because he has enough reserve energy to attack with to win if in case that happens.
Yeah, this is also one of the reasons why a lot of people decide to play stuff like Flare Grunt or Enhanced Hammer in the decks, because you can take some energies from your opponent and then slow them down this way while you have all your energies left. However, yeah, like already mentioned, Tord does not have this kind of list, so this makes it especially troublesome that he's being forced in this situation.
Yeah, right now we can just see, like, a petty energy count. Tord has got a double colorless and a dark attached to one Yveltal EX on a bench, whereas Yee Wei has 3 darks down and 2 double colorless, and all spread around on, you know, things which are just going to make Tord have a very, very bad day if this match carries on this way.
Yes. So here he just shows 6 cards, 4 max elixir, there is 1 energy card, attaching it to the other Yveltal which does not have any energy card. So far, it's enough for the bench one with the double colorless and the darkness energy to knock out the active one with Evil Ball right as it stands right now. So there is not a real need to attach additionally energies, especially considering that this just gives you more risk of using, of having the opponent knock you out with their Evil Ball. Unfortunately for Tord, he cannot go for Y Cycling right now. So Yee Wei might actually have a chance of just getting the knockout back, going down to 1 prize card and applying even more pressure to Tord.
Yeah, and this is another cool way that you can try and make sure that you keep up in terms of the tempo. If you can keep your Yveltals undamaged enough so that you force them to Evil Ball for a knockout instead of a Y Cycling, like you just said, then it makes it easier for you to knock out them in return. And at this point, as long as Yee Wei has enough energy to build up the damage so that it can actually overcome the HP increase after the Fighting Fury belt, then I think Yee Wei is going to be in a good position to win.
Yeah, I think so too. Now I'm thinking about a few stuff that here could be done. Why Cyclone moving the energy to the benched Yveltal seems also reasonable at some point, but I don't know exactly. To get enough energy, so there are right now Yveltal act on Tord side has 210 HP. This means they would need a total of 9 energy cards to take the knockout. And yeah, right now they have only 6 energy, so there is no way that the active Pokémon can get so much damage. So yeah, he just goes for the Wild Cyclone, attaching the double colors energy card to the benched Yveltal, as I would have done so as well. But again, I'm not really sure if that is the right decision. We also have to keep in mind that while Yee Wei needs to have 9 energies in total, Tord does not, because there is a Flowstone attached to the active Yveltal EX. But unfortunately, having 90 damage from the Yveltal, then plus 60 from potentially 60 from the Fright Knight will not be enough for the knockout. So Tord might be able to take an early lead if he had something like a Lysander here. But yeah, there is a lot of things going on right now.
Yeah, there is. I really like Yee Wei's play there because he did a Pokemon Center Lady at the same time. If he does the Pokemon Center Lady, that Yveltal is now, you know, fully healed, and the Y Cyclone becomes completely safe because he can just move the double colors energy as he has done. And now Tord is going to, even with the fact that there's a Floatzen on the Yveltal active instead of a Fighting Fury belt, he's still within a safe enough range to that. I think it's going to be pretty hard for Tord to get a knockout here, and he'll be probably forced to Y Cyclone himself, at which point Yee Wei will be able to take the knockout as long as he has enough energy to do a follow-up evil ball.
Yeah, this is true. When Tord, if he wants to go for evil ball, the only way for him to get a knockout, one-hit knockout, would be that there is a total of 7 energy, so 6 energy cards attached to his Yveltal. And again, similar to Yee Wei's last turn, this is not possible in this list and this board state right now. So again, he's kind of forced into Y Cyclone. Or he might also do Evil Ball just for the sake of having a better math here. This will be interesting to see what it comes down. But Tord going for Lysander Garbodor. So I'm not actually aware of how many hand cards Yee Wei has. But if he's not able to take this back, oh well, he just goes for White Cyclone and takes the knockout here. Tord now goes down to 2 prize cards, which means Lysander knockout for Shaman EX would be enough to win the game. Shaman EX, this means you need 5 energies attached in total, so if Tord is able to find an energy and a Lysander, or a Fighting Fury Belt and a Lysander, he can just take the knockout right here. And now we saw the game kind of switching around.
Yeah, that's a really, really clever play from Tord there. Taking the 1 prize knockout so that now he only has 2 prizes left means he's not forced into that 7 prize game that we always talk about so much. And now, as you rightly said, all he needs is a double colorless and he can just attack the Shaman for the knockout.
Yeah, also what Yee Wei can do here, if he has a Lysander energy, he can Lysander the bench one with the double colorless and then kind of put Tord in a not that great position. But again, it really depends on Tord's hand cards, and there is no way for Yee to predict this. He can only make good estimated guesses, and then you have to trade off. Does it make sense to take this risk or not?
Yeah, also at the same time, looking at the amount of energy now, double colors on the Shaman on the active wouldn't be enough because that would only be 90. But of course, he does have that Yveltal EX on the bench with a ton of energy on it, which with another energy on that would be enough to get a knockout. He would need the Lysander as well at the same time. But obviously, Yee Wei is not going to really let him get away with that if he can at all avoid it. As we see there, Lysander onto the bench, Yveltal with the Floatstone. So. And we're going to see, yeah, Y Cyclone from that, and he's going to move it onto the Darkrai. And now he goes down to 1 prize left, and he draws the Floatstone off of the prize there as well. But does
yeah,
Tord have a win?
Yeah, double colorless Lysander Shaman, knockout 2 prize cards, and yeah.
There it is.
Just like said, this is the one win option Tord had to win this turn. He managed to get it, and yeah, he just takes a win here. So that was a cool game because, yeah, as we said right at the beginning, it looked pretty good for Yee. He had a lot of energies in play, but considerably maybe did a few things not in the optimal way. You saw the double colorless energy card attached to the Darkrai. Didn't do anything at all. And I honestly don't really like the Darkrai that much. The attack deals, it does deal a lot of damage, but it also does take a lot of energy cards. And again, then your chance is based on a coin flip. It's a 75% chance to hit. But again, 75% can go wrong. You invest a lot of resources into that, and then you have opponents who play stuff like Olympia, Central Lady, Escape Rope, which here in this situation, of course, Tord is not doing, but even then it seems kind of odd to use this card. However, he made it into the top 8, so there has to be something.
Yeah, top 8, I mean, and again, at first seed as well, so he's had the highest Swiss record of any player of the tournament over the past 2 days, so yeah, obviously completely deserving to be here, and it's really cool to see, you know, people trying out. Over the course of the past few tournaments, it's been interesting to see how the Yveltal Garbodor deck has evolved and how people have tried to adapt their list to combat the mirror match and how different players approach that, because they all have these different sorts of things in mind that they think will give them the edge. Like, you know, we see Tord is going for these tricks with his different Pokemon. Chun has gone for the more supporter route instead, and he has this Darkrai promo. It's really cool to see how these different lists interact with each other.
Yeah, it's cool. I really like it. I'm actually a fan of the Yveltal deck. And also, I don't think the mirror matches are too bad. We had worse mirror matches. I remember Night March, which was very exciting, but it was also very luck-based.
I think Night March is considered a dirty word nowadays, David. I don't think we're allowed to say that anymore.
Oh yeah, I'm very sorry. Yeah. So, but Yveltal Garbodor is pretty cool, because there are just so many things players can do. It creates this, because it's considered the best deck right now, I think, by most people. It creates this metagame where you have just so many Yveltal Garbodors. But since it's a very tactical matchup, I really like that this deck is happened to become the best deck and not something like other decks like Rainbow Road, which just takes it off one hit knockouts.
It's a best deck that never completely unfair to play against. It always, again, it's not win more in the sense of it doesn't just, you know, aim to do something ridiculously explosive and just have this crazy turn one where it just completely overwhelms your opponent. It just builds itself up, and if you're a really skilled player and you've got a good list, you're going to do well with it. And you can just respect something like that.
Yeah, also, it doesn't really come down that much on N, just N, because both players set up their cards in play with a Float Stone and Wisex and stuff. They can do a lot of tricks here. So it's cool to see that this deck, in this format, works as it does.
Yes, definitely. So we see the Yee Wei obviously going to start off. We're going to see an Ultra Ball discarding a Max Elixir and a Dark Energy. Bit of a shame that he has to discard one, but right now, looking at what's in the rest of his hand, that's pretty much all he can go for. He could have maybe discarded the other Ultra Ball instead of the Max Elixir, but at the same time, you want your Ultra Balls later on, because a lot of these Yveltal Garbodor lists don't play Hooper. You pretty much need them even in the late game to like search out extra attackers, so that's probably why I decided to keep the Ultra Ball in hand.
It also really depends on what kind of supporter you have, so I don't really think he has any supporter at all, so playing two supporters to grab Shaman for like maximum cards drawn, like he just does, is also important. So he has to discard two Max Elixirs, actually, because he does not want to discard a double color synergy card. And here again, these are the reasons why a lot of people just play four of them, because when you play three and you play all of the three, you only need to hit one or two to win the game, but when you have to discard two, and then you only have two left, and you only hit one of them, then you are in a big disadvantage. So, here you see Yi discarding the Max Elixir wasn't that hurtful, because he still has two on his deck. However, of course, you don't really want to discard them.
Yeah, obviously, it's a case of, it's not ideal, but given the situation, you want to be able to get as much value out of your Shaman as possible to make sure that you don't just draw into a dead hand completely, and that's exactly what Yue has done, and sort of paid off. He's been able to attach a double color to the Fright Knight, and the pressure's now on Tord to mount some sort of response.
Yeah, Yee Wei now has a X Pokemon on his bench, which could be attacked by a Pitch Black Spear. However, Fright Knight blocks Float Stone, so right now there is no way for Tord to retreat this Pokemon. Like, yeah, he doesn't have any other way than Float Stone to get the active Pokemon back on the bench.
He doesn't even play Escape Rope, so that's not even an option that he can use. So there's pretty much no way for him to get, no way. There's one way that Tord could attack this turn. If he literally hits every single Max Elixir and attaches a double colorless to the active Yveltal X and retreats, then that would work.
Then he could attack, but I don't really think that makes a lot of sense here. So he just goes for attach energy, active, Float Stone. He also had the double colorless energy rather than a darkness. This allows Yi to be a bit more predictive, because he knows the next Evo Ball will definitely knock me out. If you attach a darkness energy active, you always have to think about that. Well, maybe they don't have a double colorless energy card next turn. So when I attack with Pitch Black Spear, they might not be able to take the knockout. What Yi can do, however, is evolve his Troubles and attack a Fighting Fury Belt. That would be pretty cool to see, but yeah, I'm really interested to see the next turn here. As Tord just passes.
A pretty key parallel city here, actually. So Tord has been able to be the first player to get that parallel city in play. Given that this is the only stadium both deckers are playing, now the only way that stadium is basically going to come out of play is if one of them plays a delinquent. Now that means that Yee Wei is going to be pretty much restricted to free on the bench until that happens, which means that he's not going to be able to bench as many backup attackers as he'd like.
Yeah, and Yee goes for an enhanced hammer, another disadvantage of this attaching the double colors energy card. First, it's a one-off in his deck, so it wasn't that likely to have it, but of course you have to kind of keep this stuff in mind. And now that Tord, again, it's the same situation as last turn, where he couldn't, there was no way for him to attack. And now it kind of comes down that his deck has so many struggles with dealing with the Fright Knight, because Flowstone is his only way to get his active Pokemon back. So when they don't really get a good running early on, this can come back. But again, however, just like last game, he only has one active Pokemon. This is the only Pokemon EX. And there is no Pokemon EX on his bench. So the Pitch Black Spear only did 60 damage, which is something you can live with while you set up your bench Pokemon.
Yeah, absolutely. We see there that Tord is evolving that Yveltal on the bench into the break. He's going to attach just a basic Dark to the active. And is he pretty much resigned at this point to losing this Yveltal, given that, as you said, with the Fright Knight ability, that is really not going anywhere fast. And I don't think given he's already lost a double colors energy to an enhanced hammer, I really don't think he wants to discard another one. This would mean he'd lost two already, but also not really getting any sort of value out of them at all.
Well, another thing is that Yee doesn't have any energies, so all energies he has are attached to the active Yveltal, which only deals 60 damage right now. So Yveltal EX, having the same investment, would have been way better, because Tord now outplays this Pitch Black Spear. Pitch Black Spear is incredibly good when your opponent has at least one Pokemon EX on the bench. But when your opponent just doesn't play down any Pokemon, it doesn't help a lot. And Tord discarded his whole hand for Ultra Ball, but the Sycamore then grabbed a Garbodor from his deck just to discard it with Professor Sycamore. This way the Garbodor doesn't come across his way in the future, so this is like thinning out your deck, where you grab cards you won't probably need in the future just to discard them. And yeah, now Tord is preparing next turn for a double color energy card again. He can take the knockout. And then, yeah, getting rid of the three energies attached to Yee's Yveltal. So he has to get some kind of backup plan. Here we see him Ultra Balling for Darkrai. Or not?
Yeah, he is.
Yeah, he's going for Darkrai. So I didn't believe that much in Darkrai in this matchup, but he definitely does, and he's the experienced player. He is the one with 11 wins in this tournament, so I'm going to trust him, but nope, he's also just discarding it by Professor Sycamore, so yeah, I'm happy that I distrusted the Darkrai just as he does here right now. He also couldn't have put it on his bench anyway because of the Paralyzed City, I just realized.
Yeah, that was probably it. I think had he been able to, he probably would have liked to. We saw that in the last game that he was planning to do something with it. It obviously didn't end up working out, but maybe he's hoping if he's in a real pinch of a situation that he can just use Abyssal Sleep and, you know, maybe he gets the 75% instead of the 25% and Tord stays asleep.
Ultra Garbodor, do we see the Fighting Fury Belt attached to the active Yveltal? That would be pretty cool.
Yeah, that would. But so I don't think we see it yet.
Drum roll, please. let's see. Pitchback Spear here, again, just only deals 60 damage to the active, but when you have a Fighting Fury Belt in the Garbodor, you have so much HP that Tord cannot really take the one-hit knockout. Then he could retreat, though, and then deal attack with his Pitch Black Spear to deal damage on the bench, Yveltal EX on Yee's side. So he decided not to evolve, even though he has a Gowler in his hand, and to not give Tord this option of retreating and attaching a double colors energy card and getting damage on the bench, Yveltal.
Yeah. And for that exact reason, I think that's absolutely the right play. Yee Wei is getting a lot of advantage out of this Yveltal being stuck there, essentially, and that Flowstone being turned off. If he were to evolve into Garbodor, he just opens up Tord's board so much, needlessly. So just holding onto the Garbodor for now, sure, you search it out because maybe you want to use it next turn, you discard a couple of things you know you don't want to see later, but at the same time, no need to evolve it right now. Absolutely correct, in my humble opinion.
When you look at Tord's face, it does not look like he has double colors energy card, and he just discarded a basic one. So now there is no way for him to take the knockout, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, not with his current retreating options, no, because yeah, Max Elixir isn't an option either.
He's forced into the Floatstone on the active Pokemon, So, but even if he had a Fighting Fuel Belt, it wouldn't do anything since he didn't evolve. So again, well, it didn't make a difference anyway. So not being able to take the knockout here is kind of weird, because again, Tord is in a turn where he doesn't really want to put down any Pokemon yet. Here we see the Stardust Jirachi, so well, at least something that he could use in the future. Now he deals 120 damage, so with Stardust he can actually take the knockout. Doesn't really gain that much advantage of discarding the opponent's energy, but it will be protected by the attack. So I can actually see him taking the knockout later. I don't think it makes a lot of sense to retreat now, because you have to discard two energies. And yeah, then he can just use Pitch Black Spear in the later turns to take the knockout there. But he already discarded one of his Yveltal, so there's a lot of things going on here that you have to consider.
Yeah, as we see there, Tord going for a versus EK is going to play a Professor Sycamore from that. It's got a dark energy. It would be interesting if he did retreat into the Jirachi and go for the Stardust. Obviously, that would make it immune from the Pitch Black Spear, but as you said, if he does have it on a double colors energy, then he can, of course, just Pitch Black Spear. It won't do anything to the Jirachi, but it will knock out the Yveltal. And so, yeah, for that reason, it looks like Tord is just going for the Evil Ball.
Yeah, so again, he kind of managed to not put a Pokemon EX on his bench. Now he's super out for just three Darkness energies. Of course, this makes the chance of hitting your Elixirs go higher. But I'm pretty sure now he has no Fright Knight Yveltals left once the active one gets knocked out. Again, you can think about maybe retreating and then use Y Cyclone to take a knockout active, or also just go for a Pitch Black Spear. But we see Lysander. This is cool to have here in this situation. He couldn't go for like Ultra Ball Shaman, then draw the Lysander this way. But he kind of prevents Tord from using a Stardust to get the knockout. However, now Tord can use his Pitch Black Spear to deal damage on the bench Yveltal EX on Yee's side, because the Yveltal break he has in play is the evolution form of not the Oblivion Wing Yveltal, but the Frightened one.
Yeah, another interesting play that Tord could have gone for is to just Lysander that Jirachi, because that way he would have been able to knock it out, of course, because the Fright Knight ability would negate the Fighting Fury belts, and that way he would have been able to take a double knockout there. Although at that point, as we just see there, Tord has just played an N, so Yee would have only drawn 3 off the N instead of 4. And at the same time, I think he feels that right now the Fright Knight Yveltal that's been Break Evolved is more of a threat, so it makes more sense to target this down and not just try and, you know, think too much about racing ahead for prizes.
Yeah, the 20 extra HP from the Bake Evolution make a lot of difference in this matchup, because yeah, usually you need 3 energies to attack with Pitch Black Spear, and then when you have 3 energies attached to your Yveltal EX, you can take the knockout back, but you force the opponent to take 1 extra energy when you evolve into Break. I think this is the reason why Tord's list went so far with this Yveltal Break, because in the mirror match it just gives you this advantage of making the Frightened Yveltal even harder to being knocked out. You see, there's an attack called Baleful Wind, but I don't think it will be used often, and this is not the reason why people play Yveltal Break. The reason is just to have the option to kind of upgrade your HP from the Frightened Yveltal without having to need, like, Frighting Fury Belt and Garbodor with a tool in play.
And it's also a means of being able to do damage to Jolteon next as well, which is a popular counter card that we've seen a lot, that we see. That saw a lot of play yesterday.
Yeah, but I mean, you evolve, you're still weak to Jolteon, and you cannot want it knockouted anyway. So I don't really like the Jolteon option for the Yveltal break, because it doesn't really help that much, to be honest.
Yeah, that's of course true as well. It's better than nothing, but it's still not really going to be doing you much good. So we see that Yee Wei looking through his discard pile, looking to see what he can actually do with Versus Seeker. Might be potentially eyeing up Lysander, who wants to deal with one of the bench threats. But at the same time, again, this active Yveltal break is the biggest threat on the board right now, considering it's the thing with all the energy on. So just going for a Sycamore, a bit of an ugly Sycamore.
Ouch,
actually. Yeah. Discarding a double colorless and another dark, a lot of energy resources. These energy resources, as we've discussed, are very, very valuable. They're what can like put you ahead or behind in this mirror matchup. So being forced to discard a lot like that is a little bit ugly.
Yeah, so now we see, because he played Lysander on Yveltal Break last turn, he was able to take Knockout with Evil Ball and only having just 2 energy cards. Now he cannot get, like, Stardust and, discard. He still can get attacked by Stardust, but it won't discard an energy card. But he doesn't have anything on his bench that is able to deal a lot of damage. And I think I already said this, but there are a lot of good Pokemon cards in Yee's discard pile, and he didn't shuffle them back with a Super Rod. So there might be actually a situation where he just does not find Pokemon to play with, because he already got at least two Ultra Ball. I'm actually pretty sure he already played three of them. So, and N is even more disruptive at this point.
Yeah, the one saving grace for Yee is that Tord's board energy-wise is not looking great. He's I believe he's played one Max Elixir at this point. I know he's definitely not played as many as Yee has, or discarded as many as Yee has, because we saw that he had those awkward Ultra Balls earlier. But yeah, we see Tord, they're going for the N. He's going to be able to get five off of this, and yeah, he really wants to just see Max Elixir at this point. He wants to be able to actually mount a counter-attack.
Yes. Tord had the double colors energy card in his hand before N, and since Jirachi only has one retreat cost, in theory he can retreat here. But it didn't make sense to attach the double colors energy card, because then it would just be more energy attached to the Yveltal. So if Tord happens to draw into a Max Elixir and then attach an energy, it wouldn't be enough for the one hit knockout anyways, but it would be more energy, so more damage by Evil Ball. And since there is nothing on his bench that you want to move energies for, Wise Cyclone wouldn't also be an option. So I really like that he decided to not attach the darkness energy instead of the double colorless.
Yeah, because if he can't get knockout with it anyway, he can just conserve it for later when he actually needs it more seriously. And it seems that at this point, all you can really do is go for a Stardust, no energy
discard.
Stardust
for 20.
For 20,
because
yes,
of the fighting through
your belt.
Now there is 100 HP on the Jirachi. Unfortunately, this is not going to change too much. He can still get knocked out by Y Cyclone, but I think it actually messes up the Evil Ball math. So there are only 6 Pokemon attached in total, so that's 90 damage.
But he has the Dark in hand, so he does the Y Cyclone and he takes the prize.
Oh yeah, okay. So in theory, if he didn't have the energy card, the Stardust Jirachi wouldn't have been knocked out. So that was actually a pretty cool interaction here. Just imagine you forget this, and it was just like, Evil Ball knockouts, and your opponent, no, this is not enough. We saw that earlier, where someone had the Fighting Through Belt attached to Trubbish, and then that one got 100 damage, and the opponent was just about to take a prize card, and like, no, there's a Fighting Through Belt, so the Trubbish is still not knocked out. It has, with the Fighting Through Belt, the Trubbish even has more HP than the Garbodor, so that's just an interesting interaction here. So he was able to take the knockout. Now he has two equally set up Yveltals, and Tord is kind of in a bad position here.
Yeah, he's a little bit stuck over like what to do. We saw that he opted to promote the Yveltal instead of the Trubbish. If he decided to promote the Trubbish and he saw a Floatstone, the Max Elixir would be an option to attach more energy. But as it stands, Tord is pretty much going to have to just hope to see a double colorless. But even then, if he does see a double colorless, then he attaches that and it goes for the Evil Ball, then that's the Yveltal DX on Yee Wei's bench is just ready to eat Tord's one alive, especially considering we saw that Yee just drew a double colorless himself.
Yeah, so is this enough for the knockout? There are 4 energies attached. This is not enough damage because of the Fighting Fear Belt, so...
Indeed.
Yeah, kind of problematic situation. This is one of these turns where you could think about, like, maybe you can knock out with Fright Knight Yveltal, but Tord is also... he does not have... Well, he might have one of the Fright Knight Yveltals left, so in theory he could take a knockout later on that Pokemon, but it doesn't really seem that likely, especially if he manages to find a Garbodor. He can prevent this play, as he just did. And he also has another energy for another Wise Cyclone. Now he has so many energies that to his bench Yveltal, it will be very hard for Tord to come back.
Yeah, and of course, with the double colors energy, he is still short of the knockout, so as he has done very well over the course of this game, just realizing that White Cyclone is a better option, going for that, attaching to the bench one, and yeah, Tord is just going to concede this game, and we'll be moving on to game 3.
Yeah, Tord realizes that there is no way that this can turn out in his favor. There is still half an hour on the clock left, so not that much of a time issue to concede earlier, but of course, you don't really need to give your opponent more information than you need. There's always this thing where you don't want to kind of reveal stuff of your list, but in the mirror matches, you can even like reveal plays, especially when people tend to get tired. At these tournaments, they also just forget that options exist. And when you just continue playing, they might think about more stuff. You give the opponent more time to think about the matchup in general. So conceding is not just a time-saving thing. It also can help to prevent giving your opponent too much information as you want.
Yeah, as we see there, both these players. So, I mean, there's a lot on the line here, both of them. They've got to be a little bit nervous inside. They don't look like it too much. You know, just in a typical sort of trading card game player concentration face. But other than that, I think that these guys are both ready to play out this game free to determine who's going to move on to top four.
Yeah, they're very experienced, so there's no reason to show emotions unless you kind of want to, like, trick your opponent to, like, next level plays. But these are usually very risky anyways, and often don't make a difference. So you're just sitting there with this just, like, emotionless face. And, yeah, play your cards down, think about stuff.
Yeah. So earlier, graft and roll that we saw on stream earlier seemed to be, like, out of the place we've seen on stream, it's just the master of this sort of poker face we've seen throughout.
Oh, really? I thought he just looked upset the whole game.
I was thinking back to the game he was on stream yesterday, and the whole time it was just like the same expression that barely changed. He maybe like shake his head sometimes, but it was really, really impressive how...
I really loved the expression on Michael Premot's face when he realized that there are two Frogadier's prize for craft. Yeah, but that was a different round. Now we see the prize cards for this game. Interestingly enough, there is a Center Lady prized for Yee, and there are two Professor Sycamore and two Versa Seeker and Tord's prizes. So... yeah, there are interesting prize cards. There is this one player, Philip Schulz, who plays Tonmap. He is actually still in the tournament.
Oh, we saw him earlier on stream, didn't we?
Yes. Yeah. And he plays Tonmap, so then you can look at your prize cards, and when there are a lot of good cards, you can make different plays because of this. But here we see the game. Both start with Trouble. Tord just goes for Professor Sycamore. Also a kind of problematic one because he had to discard his whole hand. He didn't play down any cards before using the Professor Sycamore. And his hand he drew afterwards also doesn't look that great. And here he has...
Oh my god. No,
please. I remember yesterday. I remember 2 days ago. And I know what Max Elixir does.
Yeah.
So what do we need here? Floatstone, Max Elixir, then either a double colors energy card or a basic energy and a fighting fury belt. Yee is getting ready, I think. And let's see if this is enough to win the game here.
I think we might be a curse on these players, David. Literally every single time it's happened, there's been the two of us commentating together. And it's been, yeah, just Max Elixir shenanigans. Like, okay, it looks like it's not going to happen again this time. Because like, we've just seen two trainers' mails. We've seen that, yeah, Yee Wei has an N in this, from the trainers' mail. He's going to play that. I mean, yeah, the chances are that he sees it from this, but...
yeah, if now Tord loses in the first round, I think we should just stop commentating at all. this is cursed.
Yeah.
I don't want to have people losing because of me. Well, but let's talk about the situation in general. Both players don't really have a good setup here. Tord had to discard a lot of resources, and here we see this probably won't be enough for the knockout anyways. So I don't think... he would risk of playing Ultimate Shaman and going for the knockout.
I mean, he could do... Oh, he's going for it.
Let's see. This could backfire a lot because using resources on stuff that is unlikely always hurts. But he was able to grab an Yveltal. Now he just passes. I think there was a draw... I'm pretty sure there was a draw supporter in his hand earlier, so I don't really like that he had to put down the Shaman, especially given that the Perilous City is facing this side, that he only has... now one bench space left. But maybe he was taking the risk, or maybe he was thinking about something completely different at all as well. Also, just having a Shaman on your bench because of Frightened Yveltal is kind of problematic. Because I think we talked about this game one, game two, where Tord just did not play Pokemon EX on his bench to prevent Pitch Black Spear from being as efficient as it can be.
Yeah.
But now he might have opened himself in the situation where Tord's Pitch Black Spear can be very, very devastating.
Yeah, I think I know the reason why it didn't happen that time. It wasn't a US player playing Yveltal against a non-US player playing Greninja. That's why this time it didn't happen.
Yeah, just something that Froakie has.
Yeah.
He just wants to get knocked out turn one.
Yeah, Froakie will star you in the case of yesterday.
They're asking for it, these water Pokemon. But yeah, here we see Troublesh. Maybe just this face looks so sad that you just cannot... knock it out turn one.
Yeah, exactly. We see the Tord getting managing to hit one of his Max Elixirs, which is great for him, and following it up with an N. He'll want to see a Floatstone off of this because, of course, he doesn't want to keep that Travis in the active spot.
Floatstone DC would be incredible. He could retreat, then use Pitch Black Spear, 60 on the Trubbish. Then Floatstone would not be enough to retreat because, yeah, Frightened Yveltal is active. And he would need to evolve into Garbodor, then turning off. Oh, here we see a double colors entry card. Does he find a float zone? Unfortunately, no. Not for him. So it would have been, I think, a really, really strong turn.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's still a decent turn. You know, he's got a couple of energy down. He's definitely still in a fine position, especially considering that Yee Wei's board is a lot more vulnerable to Fright Knight than Tord's is to Yee, because obviously Tord has managed to not bench any EX Pokemon, which is great for him. Also, we see that cleverly again, he's opting to attach a basic dark instead
of
a double colors.
Please do not attach the double colors energy card when your opponent plays Enhanced Emerald. You have other choices.
Yeah. It's a very good play for Tord, recognizing that after that punishment last game, that attaching the base dark was the better choice. Yee Wei is now going to be placed, we're going to be passing back to him. He sees an Ultra Ball, he's going to discard the Parallel City. Of course, can't make much use of that now that Tord's already played one. He's also discarding a Trubbish.
Yeah, you don't need more than one Trubbish in play, even in this matchup. And he actually just goes for Garbodor, so no Yveltal EX, nothing like Darkrai, for example. So if he wants to retreat, he also needs the ability lock. So it could become a bit problematic, but maybe we will see the force of a Fighting Fury Belt Pitch Black Spear.
Yeah, perhaps, although we see that Yee has missed the Float Stone, which is a little bit unfortunate for him. He's got a Max Elixir, so he can use that to start and build up his board a little bit more, but both players really sort of missing the key, well, just both missing Float Stones so they can actually attack.
Yeah, Yee also, didn't he miss two Max Elixirs and two Trainer's Mane and now Max Elixir? So he's just... These cards just say, look at your top cards, and then take them back. kind of unfortunate for him. Until we see Tord's turn again. Now he has a couple of options. I see a Lysander in his hand. Don't really think it makes too much sense playing this now, but it could open him to play like Lysander for the Fright Knight. But of course, given that he needs a Floatstone first, otherwise it doesn't make a lot of sense to play the Lysander at all, because, well, he cannot attack this turn. He has a Versa Seeker, so he could grab a Professor Sycamore or an N. When he grabs a Sycamore, of course, he can discard a Lysander and a Trubbish, so cards that you want to have in the discard pile. You don't need the Trubbish anymore, since he already has one in play. And Lysander in the discard pile means Versa Seeker for the future will give you the Lysander, so just having bigger odds. And we also see him getting the Floatstone.
Yeah, this is great for Tord. This is exactly what he wanted to see. And I think this is why he played the Sycamore as well. Of course, discarding cards you don't want and drawing more than one extra card than the N would have done means that you're more likely to hit that Floatstone. And when there's one key card you want to hit, sometimes you just really have to be aggressive with that Sycamore and recognize to do that at the right time is exactly what Tord's done there, and it's paid off in spades.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of sad that he had to evolve the Yveltal into Break and not was able to attach a Fighting Fuel Belt to it, because that would have been so cool, just like outplaying the fact that there is Garbodor active, which can only retreat by attaching a Floatstone, which was then forcefully turn off the ability. But of course, when you don't know your... Like, he didn't even draw the Fighting Fury Belt anyway, so evolving was a better turn.
Yeah.
But maybe we have a lot of mirror matches to go, so I think this will happen at some point anyways.
Yeah, I'd be surprised if we didn't see it. And going back to Yee, we see he decides to go for the end at this point, and he really needs to see a Floatstone now. He needs to retreat and actually start attacking. Because if he doesn't, then Tord is just going to do another Pitch Black Spear, and then that Yveltal EX on the bench is not going to be looking healthy.
Yeah, what I really like at the spot position in Yee's perspective is that there is no Yveltal EX on Tord's bench. So in order for him to take the knockout on the Yveltal that Yee has, he would need Elixir, Energy, and Yveltal. So he would need to find a way to get Yveltal before attaching Energy, but...
Ooh.
Oh, there is no Floatstone. We see there is one prize for Yee, but that should still mean he had two left. And now Tord, he can just go for the three-hit knockout on the benched Yveltal as long... Because Yee's Sentry Lady's in the prize cards, which Tord doesn't know, but this is just a fact that when he attacks... Like, if he's able to attack with the bench Fright Knight Yveltal as well, he can take knockout on Garbodor, so forcing, stopping the option for Yee to turn off the Fright Knight, and then the Fighting Fury Belt would not have the ability to give Yveltal EX on the bench extra HP. And then Tord would just need a double color sentry card or any way to attack with Pitch Black Spear and then take out the Yveltal EX on Yee's bench afterwards. So this is a great, great spot Tord is in here.
Yeah, and we see now that Tord also has an Yveltal EX ready to go. He's put a Fighting Fury Belt and a Dark Energy on it, so now he's going to be able to put himself in the position where he can like KO things more easily, and he doesn't have to worry about, you know, hitting so much in one turn to do it. So an excellent turn for Tord there, and a really, really unfortunate one for Yee, as we see play passes back to him. He is going to be able to promote this Yveltal into the active now, and then he will be able to take a knockout, but he's only taking it for one prize as well. I mean, granted, they'll put the both of them even, but then at that point, but given it's so damaged, Tord can just come straight back in with his own attacker, and at that point, Yee's just left with not much of anything.
Yeah, like I already said, the amount of prize cards doesn't really tell you anything mm-hmm. about which player is ahead or which player right now has a better chance. I think the only thing prize cards actually really do is just like stuff like N, changing the way how many cards you draw. So when you have an early lead and your opponent's playing very conservatively, not taking one hit knockouts, but dealing a bit damage on a lot of Pokemon, and that makes a difference. And here, he just goes for a Lysander actually, so not even taking the knockout. Taking the knockout here would mean that he would kind of gamble that your opponent doesn't have a double color sentry card. However, now playing Lysander on Yveltal, if Tord has a double color sentry card, he can take the knockout regardless, so he can either retreat onto the Yveltal break again, which then would be in a great spot because of the 150 HP. So if he has a double color sentry card on his bench Yveltal EX, he would not be able to take the knockout, so he'd need to hit the max elixir. We already saw that there, that these max elixir didn't hit for Yee already, so there aren't four of them left. Even though he didn't, I think he didn't attach too many entry cards by max elixir, so the situation looks good for Tord. I'm really interested to see if Tord just goes for Y-Cyclone or retreats for the double color sentry card, because I can see both plays making a lot of sense here.
I think as long as Tord is able to, because we've seen Tord does have the double colors in hand, so yes, we know that this is an attacking option. I think it would be really great if Tord could have access to another Yveltal EX, because then of course he can Y-Cycle and move on to that, and I think that would be the optimal thing to do.
He now has two versus Seeker in a sense, so he can Lysander Shaman, then retreat, use Pitch Black Spear, so this is another option he has. And now you as the viewers can of course think about what makes more sense. I don't want to think about what makes more sense. I would just wait to see what Tord is going for. And here we see him Lysandering actually the Yveltal, and now he has the option to retreat or Y-Cyclone. Or Evil Ball even. He has so many options. It's incredible.
Actually, I'm not sure. How would he be able to, if he wants to attach to, he can attach to the active and you know, of course retreat to the Yveltal break.
Yes.
That would be the way he does that. But
yeah, that would mean that he kind of discards a double color sentry card, but Y-Cyclone will give him a bit damage. He can still, like, taking the knockout on the bench Yveltal isn't really important because he knows he's the one with the Trubbish and the Float Zone. The opponent has no way to shut off Fright Knight, so as long as Tord does not evolve, he will always just be able to attack and take a knockout. And here we see him. What is this? Evil Ball? Looks like Evil Ball.
Yeah, I think he's decided that the energy is.
Oh! Evil Ball does 110 damage, so this is the double knockout range for Pitch Black Spear, so I didn't even realize that Evil Ball right now does 110 damage. And yeah, like I already said, there is no way for Yee to turn off this Fright Knight, so potentially Tord can just take two prize cards next turn.
That's an extraordinary play from Tord there, putting Yee in the ugliest position right now. If Yee doesn't see a Pokemon Center Lady, and we know he can't see a Pokemon Center Lady because it's in the prize cards, then yeah, he's forced to Y-Cyclone, but then did he attach to the Yveltal with the Fright Knight? This is just, wow, that's a really incredible
because
play.
Because next turn, the important thing on Tord's field will be Fright Knight Yveltal.
Yes.
And then you need three hits to knock it out with your one. And then he attacks twice again afterwards, and then can just take the knockout on Shaman. And actually, in theory, he can attach another Darkness Energy to the active Yveltal, and then just one hit, that's just take a lot of damage with the Yveltal break. Here we see an Enhanced Hammer, so Yee's last resort of preventing Pitch Black Spear. But I'm pretty sure Tord has a double color energy card in his hand.
Yeah, it's unfortunate for Yee. Obviously, it would have been otherwise really great. That's the one means he had of trying to stop this Pitch Black Spear from coming in. But if Tord just is able to announce Pitch Black Spear next turn, if he does have the double colors in hand, then yeah, at that point, he's just so far ahead. There's almost nothing he can do.
So many energy cards gone. And now he's thinking, like, what do I even do with this Fighting Fury build? It needs more damage, and the active one has more HP anyway, so I think it will be a bit more valuable if the active one does not get knocked out. But he goes for Y-Cyclone, yeah, attaching a double color sentry card to the bench. Fright Knight, Yveltal, preparing in the case that Tord does have a double color sentry card to take out both Yveltal EX on Yee's side. Tord can just put the Floodstone Trubbish active, but he goes straight with the Yveltal break. So that should mean that he has a double color card in his hand, and he is sure, yeah, That was so fast, just like, I don't need to think about this, give me your four prize cards.
Yeah, that Fighting Fury Belt is not going to do anything against that ability of the Fright Knight Yveltal, and we are now going to see a four prize knockout, which is just an incredible turn for Tord.
Well, we are potentially seeing a four prize knockout. I'm just thinking about if there is anything that makes sense, because the active Yveltal only has one energy card attached to, so something like playing Lysander on the bench Yveltal Fright Knight to just get some damage off already could also make sense, but I'm sure the most likeliest play is you just grabbing all your prize cards, and then, because the problem is you don't usually want to take as many prize cards, like we said, just having drawn more prize cards doesn't really put you in a favorable position in general. Also, when you take out all your opponent's Pokemon EX, Tord has one Yveltal on his bench, so nothing too big that can deal too much damage right here. So when Yee plays an N afterwards, he will put, he only has one hand card, no energies and fear. That could be an issue that Tord might have to deal with. Yeah, but like I already said, I think the best play here is just to take out all of them.
Yeah, you put yourself on one prize card left, and especially now that Tord has just benched an Yveltal with a Float Stone, I think that this absolutely makes the most sense to do.
Yeah, he also has the Oblivion Wing, so as long as he has just like one energy card, he can also deal some damage, especially there is Float Stone on the Oblivion Wing one. Yeah. And yeah, four prize cards taken, this is so satisfying.
Yeah, it's Pitch Black Spear for 60 and 60, a double knockout on two Yveltal EXs, and now the pressure's really on Yee to mount some sort of response, and looks like his option there is pretty much just to send out the Pitch Black Spear. Be a Yveltal, he'll be able to do 60 to the opponent's active and be able maybe to do 60 to the Yveltal on the bench, but that's not doing enough right now.
Yes, yes, totally agree. Also, there is. He can't really take the knockout here. This will be problematic. I'm figuring out a way to play around this, so when he gets damage on the active one, he doesn't have. Does he play Team Flareground?
Who does?
Yee.
No,
so it doesn't
seem
like it. He already uses Enhanced Hammer, so he cannot go for like a disruption option. He has a double colors and energy to his Yveltal EX, and now he goes for probably N.
Yeah.
Just to, yeah, now give Tord only one hand card, and this is where he has to take a little risky. But, yeah, like I already said, just taking the forward knockout, even though it looks pretty cool and impressive, doesn't win you the game right there, because Yee now can deal 60 damage active, 60 on the bench Pokemon. Then retreat into the Yveltal EX, take knockouts, and then because Tord only has one prize card left anyways, he just needs to kind of like hope Tord doesn't draw a lot of energy cards and then continue playing energies to the active. So this game definitely is not over, even though it looked pretty cool to just like draw almost all of your prize cards.
Although it's funny, something that happened at the very start of this game may actually now come back to bite Yee Wei. You see there the Shaman Lee bench at the start of the game to try and go for that first turn win. That's now only two back Pitch Black Spears away from being knocked out. So now he's going to hit his in the active, and even if this even if it's knocked out, the active Yveltal that Tord has, as long as he has enough energy to attack with his bench Fright Knight Yveltal, then then the game's over there. So that Shaman is really coming back to bite him.
Yeah, let's see if... wait, what?
What? Okay, there's a bit of a confusion. It looks like he announced Lysander on one, but he's asking to change his mind?
Well, he showed this Yveltal on that side, but... I think he wanted to put the Oblivion one active, then retreat into his Fright Knight Yveltal to, yeah, prevent Tord from retreating. And now there is kind of a discussion going on. I think this is a weird situation because what you do is you show Lysander and then tip on an Yveltal and you say Lysander Yveltal, but there are two Yveltal next to each other, so it's really hard to see from here. It looked like he wanted to go for the other Fright Knight on the bench, but of course. I mean, that's just a few centimeters, and the card has a big, big field, so it will be interesting to see how the situation looks like. I also wanted to say that if Yee has a double colors energy card, he can also just scurry turn, but his hand doesn't look like there is a double colors in his hand. Also not entirely sure if he even has one left. I unfortunately didn't count this with me, and now there is kind of discussion going on if the judge is allowing it. Yeah. And this is one of these like communication problems where... You didn't, like, technically, what you would have to do is play Lysander and then say Lysander on this Yveltal here. But he just pointed with the Lysander, so it really depends on what he said and how the head judge feels like yeah. with the situation.
Yeah, this is why communication with your opponent is so key here. We see this cropping up every now and again, where someone will, you know, in a rush to try and, you know, play fast, they'll just, you know, do a hand motion, they'll, you know, try to say, oh yeah, like Lysander Yveltal, like you said. But in this situation, there's where there's two choices that that can mean, and as you said, the card is big enough where the motion could look like it's one or the other. It's just a really awkward situation to be in, because now it basically comes down to a matter of the judge deciding whether the intention was clear enough.
Yeah, we had something similar yesterday with Niklas, where he had the Versus Seeker in his hand and then said Lysander on this one without taking the Lysander from his discard pile. Oh, but unfortunately it did not turn out in Yee's favor. He could not take it back. So the judges decided that it was his clear communication that he wanted the Yveltal with the threatened ability active, which he did not want. Maybe he wanted it firstly and then realized that it doesn't make any sense, because right now they're just deadlocking each other. He also risks that if Torchas has any energy card, he can retreat and attack with Pitch Black Spear. And now when Yee attacks the Darkness Energy active, he can retreat, but that doesn't help him too much. He still needs 4 prize cards, so as long as Tord
is.
And here it is! Just energy, he then retreats into the Yveltal break, takes the knockout, and yeah, you can actually hear the crowd, they are so loud. So much hype going on here.
Congratulations to Tord Reklev of Norway, you have just advanced to the top 4 of the European International Championships, and what an ending.
What an amazing match, yeah. I think if it had been the way where yeah, it was the right Yveltal on Yee's side, so you could have taken the Oblivion Wing one active, then retreat into his Fright Knight, and attack Tord would have had attention energy active. Yeah, it would have come down if Tord was able to find a second energy later on. But it wasn't. Of course, it would have given Yee a better winning option, definitely. But it didn't really make that he. It didn't mean that he would have to win there, I think.
Yeah, so obviously Yee's going to be a little bit disappointed about how that ended, but at the same time, an incredible result, you know, to come all the way from Malaysia to the European International Championships and not only make your top 32, not only make top 8, but to come first seed as well, literally the best player in Swiss across the, you know, 2 days that we had of the Swiss round. An incredible achievement by any player's standards.
Yeah, top 8 is just insane, because there are so many good players from all around the world here. You have a lot of players from the United States, you have a lot of players from all of course Europe, and like I already said, already also a few players from Asia. So being top 8 here is like almost world championship class. It's really amazing to see that all kind of players make it through. Of course, we are very happy for the that a good player made its way through here into the top 8, but then you only face other good players, and then yeah, it kind of comes down to luck, but also to these plays. You saw, it was his, like, these little mistakes, just being a bit off with your Lysander can cost you a game. So that's kind of fortunate, but this happens and you have to be aware of this.
Yeah, it's, I mean, what would you say, looking back to that match, what would you say was the key sort of clincher for Tord there? Because I mean, there were so many different things that were going on over the course of those few games, that just these tiny little decisions that edged it for, like, you know, one way or the other. In fact, at one point we thought that we were sure that Yee was going to win one of the games, but then Tord managed to pull it back, which was really impressive.
Well, I wasn't that sure that he wins. Of course, the game position in general looked better for him, but these mirror matches, especially the Yveltal mirror matches, are very hard to predict. Because there is so much stuff going on, and at the end always changes a lot, and also stuff like Lysander and then having your Frightened Yveltal active, blocking the Flood Stones. So there are always a lot of options, and also I can't decide on like one turn that was very important, because every single turn something important happened for this matchup. So yeah, that's really cool to have.
Yeah, so we are going to go over to our main stage now to have an interview with our winner. Over to you, Ryan.
Hello everyone, and what an amazing and close and tense game we just saw there. Your match with Yee, wow, I don't know what to say. How are you feeling?
I don't know what to feel. I knew I only needed an energy for the win when he whiffed Floatstones for a couple turns, put me in a huge lead. So I got energy of 10-1 after 2 turns and I got the win.
Yeah, you definitely did. And I mean, just generally, what was your game plan for the mirror? How are you planning to navigate that?
I was planning to open Fright Knight Yveltal if he didn't have energy attached to his active Yveltal EX. And if he did, I had to go for the Yveltal EX myself. And then go from there.
Now, I noticed, I mean, you're the only one that I've seen utilizing Yveltal Break. What's the decision behind that?
You can give the Fright Knight Yveltal 20 extra HP. And it's really good in mirror because you don't have to set Garbodor to boost his HP. And then your opponent needs more energy to KO it with Evil Ball.
Oh, that's very smart, actually. All right. Now, I have to get to this, but when Yee showed that Lysander, what was going through your head?
I was like, is really Lysander that Pokemon? He forgot that he had that had the same ability, so he can retreat and attack. But I think that in the end it wouldn't matter. He was 4 prize behind, and as long as he didn't end me, I would have gotten the Garbodor and the energy in the end anyway to KO the Shaymin. So.
Oh wow, awesome stuff. So you now move into top 4. How are you feeling for your next match?
I don't know really, I didn't expect to win this one at all. So drink some water and I will play my best and hope for the best.
Yes, of course. You've won the Norwegian Nationals 3 times, is that correct?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So what would winning this tournament mean for you?
Norwegian Nationals is pretty small compared to all other nationals and tournaments around the world. So this will be huge for me, and with so much money on the line, it'd be amazing.
Of course, of course. I can only wish you the very, very best of luck moving forward. Congratulations on your win. And take it away. Over to you, casters.
Thank you very much, Ryan. So, yeah, it was really great to hear from Tord there. As you very rightly mentioned, David, the Yveltal Break there, I think, yeah, the main reason why he played it, although obviously it is a counter to Jolteon, it's not brilliant in that sort of sense, but the extra HP really makes a huge difference in the mirror, so it makes complete sense that he'd play it for this reason.
Yeah, also in theory, when you have 3 energies attached to it, often that actually happens where you have reattach an energy, and then next turn you hit the max elixir and have darkness energy in your hand, so you think, maybe I can just attach 3 darkness energy and then use pitch black spear. And well, then you break evolve and you can have the 130 damage, which is able to one hit knock out an opponent's Yveltal, for example. So the card, yeah, mainly just for more HP because you can't attach Fighting Fury Bird there. But also, it's a cool card to have in general. And since he is a top 4, it really showed.
Yeah, and it's all of these small card decisions that can make the big difference, as we mentioned so many times before, between making top 32 or making top 8 and not. Paying off in spades again for Tord. Congratulations to him. He will be moving on to top 4, and we will be moving on to our next top 4 game very shortly. So we've got our bracket ready for the top 4. We're going to be showing that in a little bit, but until the next round, don't go away.
Yeah, I really hope you got to come out with it. We'll be right back.